Welcome you all to the Wellness India Expo 2017. And we're now about to begin the third session for the day, which is Animal Bio, Moving the World for Animals. I request all our eminent panelists to please come on the dais. Dr. S. R. Rao, Advisor, Department of Biotechnology. Dr. Subeer S. Mazumdar, Director, National Institute of Animal Biotechnology. Dr. Manilal Valliyate, CEO, PETA. Mr. Kartick Satyanarayan, Co-Founder and CEO, Wildlife SOS. Dr. Vijay Pal Singh, Assistant Professor, Academy of Scientific and Innovative Research. I now request our session chair, Dr. S. R. Rao, to please take the session forward.
So, good afternoon, all of you. Welcome to this session on animal welfare, particularly moving the world of animals. We have very eminent speakers. The microphone is working. We have eminent speakers in various areas of animal welfare and animal technologies. We will be covering mostly on animal health and welfare, treatment of infectious diseases, science of animal breeding and genetics, and then use of antibiotics in livestock. So some of these aspects will be touched by our speakers. But before I am given some minutes to speak, to put a foundation for this. When we talk of animals, what comes to our mind when you close our eyes? Somebody will think it is cow, somebody will think it is dog, somebody will think it is a cat, somebody will think lion, so some other people think mouse and rat. So actually the animals, we slowly we are even forgetting even agriculture crops. So animals are not in our mind greatly. Animals include everything that is a living being other than humans. You have birds, you have mouse, you have rat, cows, buffaloes, mithuns. In the northeast, there are animals called mithun. And you have got swine, you have got dogs, cats, and then wildlife. So there are a range of animals. Without them, they are linked with food chain, they are linked with our welfare, and we are all emphasizing about trees. We are emphasizing about agriculture crops. So there is a very little emphasis on animals. They are part of our entire life. So if you go to what are the areas which are actually affecting the animal welfare and animal wellness and also application of technology. One of the most important thing is the policies that the government makes are very important. And one will wonder that every ministry connected with livestock, every ministry connected with the what you call diseases, they have one policy or other. And there are many animals for which nobody has any policy. For example, I'll tell you, we in the Department of Biotechnology work for promoting development of vaccines, diagnostics, and then genetics for breeding of animals. We also use a lot of technologies through mouse and rat for development of new technologies, new vaccines, and then range of technology interventions are done for animal welfare, animal productivity, and also producing novel drugs, drug discovery. But what is more important is, recently I found that when, take for example a what you call pet dog or a dog which is there on the street, or the community dogs. So what I found was, in the entire country, there is no canine health research. There is no health research on a scale that is required for addressing the welfare of these animals. When you go to a Ministry of Agriculture, they say that a livestock nahi hai. Isse agriculture ke liye important nahi hai. Although it is used as a security dog, so they say it is not part of the agriculture. When you go to the medical health and family welfare, they say that we are only concerned about the rabies. So rabies aata hai human beings ko, toh, that is only our concern. Dog is not our concern. Then we took a decision that by through wide consultation globally, because nowadays pet dog market is increasing. There are about 1500 crores in pet dog health market. There are 500 crores, the pedigree is being sold as a feed. Nobody notices this. And then most of the vaccines which are used for our pet dogs are imported. And they are from Pfizer and they are from many multinationals. Some of the dog feed is also imported. So we have ignored like that many animals. We have not taken care of them in terms of their health, nutrition, their own reproduction, their presence in the communities, and their own pain and their own diseases. We are now starting in Gadwasu, that is in Punjab, Ludhiana, a canine research center in partnership with Veterinary University. Similarly, another center we are starting in Tamil Nadu Veterinary University for South, a canine research center. So you don't have many tools like us. You don't have blood testing kits, blood banks are not there, and then you don't have, basic minimum health facilities in many places. There are shortage of it. Because the concentration is on livestock, not on other things. Some of the hospitals do cater to birds and also the dogs. And then the wide range of animals which are on the wild. So how our technologies can address to minimize their sufferings. I was just 15 days ago, I was in US. So there is a whole area of new technologies that are coming, which is called genome editing. One will say that genetic engineering is bad, or one will say genome editing is bad, genetics is bad, selection is bad. But what the targeted traits which the new technology is addressing is animal welfare activities. For example, it was surprising for me to see in a video that in poultry industry, in many of the large scale poultries, when the egg hatches, within 1 week, there is a microscopic identification of male and females. The male is thrown like this, and the female is put on pedestal. So this video showed that in a day, some thousands of males are thrown, and that becomes a carcass. So what this scientist has done, I'm giving example of technology, that he has put two genes in the male part of the chromosome, and then when it hatches, you can just put a light and see it is a male. So the other gene has a high protein content. So the egg directly goes into manufacturing of protein instead of hatching it and killing it. So they call it as, in Australia, research people are calling it as ethical eggs. So similarly, in case of swine, in case of cattle, there are many other traits where animals are sacrificed, animals are not taken care. So there is an effort using genome editing technologies to address heavily on animal welfare traits. For example, in Africa, cattle get a very severe disease. Whatever you do, it won't go trypanosomiasis. So they have developed a technology in which the very embryonic stage, the genes are modified to make it resistant. So in India, you know, goshalas, if you go to, I was just coming from Mathura. In Mathura, there is a veterinary college. But outside Mathura, there is a temple. Of course, there is a poaching of human beings also for the temple. That is apart. But you can see that in one street, you can see 100 cows, unproductive cows, and those bulls simply lying on the street. And you find that they are infected with ticks. They are infected with bovine tuberculosis, paratuberculosis, brucellosis. Some of these diseases Why animal welfare is important for us? Because these diseases also are transmitted to humans. Even if a healthy and even an animal which is in dairy has got these animals, the milk is dangerous. We don't realize all these things. So it is doubly important for us to use policy, technology, and as well as the practices of farmers who are best practices, practices of people who keep these animals, all merged together to see that wide range of animal welfare activities take place. In this game, there are many people who may are policy makers like us, who are people having their own attitudes. Religion comes in the picture. There are people who are termed as activists. There are activists with rationale. There are idealistic activists. For example, people are being killed. Even if you are taking a cow for a veterinary college, so somebody may kill you because they think that you are taking it for a slaughter. So there are rational activists, there are idealistic activists, and there are other stakeholders who are interested in business, dairy, poultry, and then increasing this business to meet the demands of food needs of the people. So the whole animal issues are very complicated and complex. At the same time, we have to appreciate that our importance given to the animal welfare and animals as a whole is not as much as we should have given. So I think today our panelists will tell you some of these issues, some of these concerns, and Dr. Subeer Mazumdar will be telling about the technologies. So it is a mixed bag. You can hear all those concerns from all our speakers. They are very eminent people. As and when they come, I'll just briefly give their introduction so that you know who is this person speaking on behalf of whom and what is his way of thinking and what is his field of work. So I welcome all of you on the stage and I welcome all the audience. And when you have questions, maybe, I think, I don't know what is the sequence, after the talk or at the end? Panel discussion at the end. So what is the time given to speakers? 10 to 12 minutes, okay. So when it is 8 minutes, I'll give you a stop. And then you finish, try to do it in 10 minutes. Actually, I as a speaker myself, I saw it's about 6 minutes now. They said 7 minutes. The important thing is, as a speaker on the stage, the first thing is to respect you and respect your time. So then everything will be all right. Thank you very much. So in the sequence, there are... So I'll just call first Mr. Kartick Satyanarayan, co-founder and CEO, Wildlife SOS India.
Hi, can you all hear me? Okay. I have a timer, so I'm going to try and stay within the 12 minutes that I've got. Thank you. Thank you very much for having me here. I'm very happy that the Wellness Expo is being done in such a great way, and I'm very impressed. I did not expect such a big turnout over here. And, you know, and today's session is about moving the world for animals. I'm going to start by saying, you know, what is wellness? Wellness, I mean, it's a desirable state, right, for all of us. It is a very desirable state. And one of the things that I see, and, you know, some of our panelists, I'm sure, share the opinion, is that, you know, being kind and compassionate can actually get you a great sense of wellness around yourself. Because if you're happy and peaceful, I think it's very easy to see that state. And wellness is also a mental state. So I'll start by saying namaste. My name is Kartick Satyanarayan. I'm the co-founder of Wildlife SOS. I have another co-founder called Geeta Seshamani. She also runs another organization called Friendicos. I'd like to tell you a little bit about the state of wellness that I had growing up, very briefly. So this is kind of where I grew up. This is in Karnataka. It's a national park called the Banargatta National Park. And my state of wellness was best when I was in the forest, bunking school, sitting on top of a tree near a water hole, watching wild animals coming to drink. That was my state of wellness. That's where I got a real big high on that, and that's what got me moving into the area of trying to work with animals, animal welfare, and wildlife conservation. Now, very briefly, how many of you know what this what this animal is. I know the screen is kind of fuzzy, so you probably can't read. It's a sloth bear, okay? It's a very severely endangered bear, and it's only found in the Indian subcontinent. Now, it's even more rarer than the tiger to see this bear, but not so long ago, many of you would have seen the sight of the Madari with the Bhalu as children, or perhaps in your time living in North India or South India. This used to happen across India. It was a 400-year-old practice. And every single bear that you had on the street was actually removed from the forest as a little baby bear, a cub. The mother would be killed and the baby would be removed. And then that baby bear would then be sold to a community called the Kalandars. These were nomadic gypsy communities, tribes, who had entered India from Persia 400 years ago to entertain the Mughal emperors and their harem. And these babies would be weighing, like Dr. Rao said, you know, little puppies, you know, the size of maybe a German Shepherd puppy or something. They would hold it down, use a red hot iron poker, put a hole through the muzzle, put a rope through it, and then beat that animal, cut off its teeth, break its teeth actually with a metal rod, and then cut off its claws, and then make it perform like that on the street. This was so the community could make a little bit of money. You know, they would earn a few rupees every day, 50 to 100 rupees. Sometimes they would make a couple of hundred rupees. So we had to, this was a problem across India. So the wellness of these animals was severely hampered, and the community was doing something which was illegal. So coming back to our topic of moving the world for animals, what could have been done to solve this? You know, what could somebody do? And this was India in the 21st century. I mean, we are moving so fast ahead with everything else. How could we see something like this? So Wildlife SO, as the organization I head and founded, started working with this community. So we started looking at sustainable solutions with the community. What can we help them do so they don't have to depend on these bears and they don't have to poach these animals? Because if they get caught, arrested and jailed, they could get a sentence for up to 7 years. It's a non-bailable, non-compoundable sentence. So we thought, you know, let's help these people. None of the children went to school. So we started working with the community. Of course, we started working with the women initially because, you know, they are the more intelligent species of human beings that we know. And through them, we were able to connect with the children in the community. And in return for working with the community, we started offering them alternative livelihoods, sending the children to school. And we were able to get them to willingly surrender all the bears that they had in their custody. So you can see all of the children. We support over 1,600 children currently. I think it's nearing 1,800. We pay for their school fees, their books, their uniforms, etc. So they did not have to continue to do this on the streets. And then we started working with the men. We gave them alternative livelihoods. We took away their bears, and which they willingly surrendered. And in return, we helped them get seed funds for getting an auto rickshaw, setting up a shop, and things like that. That changed the community's future. Because they then did not have to indulge in something illegal. They didn't have to poach animals from the wild, and neither did they have to run from the law. So they were able to sustain themselves, send their children to school, and support themselves. In return, the bears that would come to us would come in this shape. You can see the teeth on the left side. All the canines have been brutally broken out. And so we would anesthetize the bears. We set up 4 bear rehabilitation centers in India. The first one is in Agra. It's the biggest one in the world for sloth bears. It's 160 acres. All of you are invited to come there, learn about Wildlife SOS, come and visit us there. We have a team of veterinarians who actually do root canal surgeries on these bears because the teeth are so badly messed up. I mean, how many of you have had toothache? Everyone, right? Pretty much. How bad is it when you have a bad toothache, right? It's painful. So that's what these bears were suffering every single day of their lives. So we actually did that and we fixed them. And this is how the bear is coming, typically weighing about 30, 35 kilos, messed up completely. And that's the after photo on the right-hand side that you can see. So this is what we did with this community. We ended up collecting 628 bears over the period of 9 years that we worked with this community. And we rehabilitated 3,000 families. We empowered the women. It's a very patriarchal community, so we empowered the women, got the children into school. So that was a complete sustainable solution. So we addressed the wellness not only of the animals, but also of the people, the community, the children, and the women. But moving forward, what were the challenges moving forward? The habitat of the sloth bears was going away. You know, the roads that we use, the jelly that is under the tar is broken and blasted, dynamited from their habitat. This is the habitat. The granite stones and rocks and boulder fields. That's where all the granite comes from. So we had to start working on protecting their habitat, which was a huge major problem. And then also, this is a mother bear with her two cubs on her back. That's how she transports her cubs. And so the cub poaching was continuing because we have something called traditional Chinese medicine. And being a wellness expo, I think it's very relevant for all of us to know this, that there is traditional Chinese medicine which uses bear body parts, gallbladder, penis, bear paw soup is a very famous thing where they cut off the paws and they make a soup with it. It's a delicacy. And so that's a major issue that we are having to deal with. It's illegal, but it's being the bears are killed in India. Then these body parts are transported through Nepal and various countries across into China for this. And of course, it doesn't work. There's no evidence that it works. There's alternatives which work much better. And then, of course, we have bear dancing in Nepal, and we have bear baiting in Pakistan, in the Northwest Frontier Province, which is a problem and causing problems for our bears over here. And those are the gallbladders and the bile that I was talking about just now. So one of the things that Wildlife SOS does is we work with enforcement agencies, with the police, with the customs, with the forest department in various states across India, in over 13 states. And we partner with them and try and track down wildlife criminals. We carry out investigations, help with the prosecution. And this is a rare photograph. A smiling policeman in Uttar Pradesh is not very common. So, you know, but it gives them a lot of motivation. They feel so thrilled that they can help one animal. So that one bear cub that he's helped, look at the smile on his face. I mean, look at the wellness he's achieved at that point in time, you know. So it's very relevant that this can change us. So we also work with implementation of wildlife laws. India has one of the best wildlife laws in the world, very progressive, but the implementation is a bit of a problem. So that's one of the things that we work with. We've rescued over 70 sloth bear cubs till now. The business of poaching, some of you might not know about this, but it's all connected with the wellness industry, the so-called medical industry and the traditional Chinese medicine. It's only next to narcotic smuggling. It's a multi-billion dollar industry, $28 billion in that region. And because we have so many of these porous borders around India, it becomes difficult for us to kind of control it. This is a tiger in a jaw trap. And if the tiger was, this particular tiger was saved, but it lost its leg, so it can never be released back in the wild. And if it had not been saved, it would have been reduced to a piece of skin and some bones, and all this would have been packaged off and sent off to China and the Southeast Asian countries for use in medicine, Chinese traditional medicine. So are pangolins, owls, etc. So this is something that we all kind of need to be aware about and learn about and be conscious about. One of the things that we do is wildlife crime enforcement. We have manuals. We do a lot of training in the field. We also work with communities who've been and you know, from the time the ancestors, they've been poaching wildlife, like the saperas. You see these snake charmers on the streets of India, and we try and rehabilitate them. We have to retrain them. Sometimes we have to give them a slap or two to help them understand that you don't handle animals this way. But then they learn how to handle animals the right way. We retrain them and then use them in the field to relocate animals. For example, we translocated 172 Nilgai antelopes from the Delhi International Airport in order for it to be safe for planes to land. This is a hyena being rescued by our team. So we do a lot of work with human-wildlife conflicts. So any of you have a snake in your house, if you call the police or the fire department, they call us. They'll call Wildlife SOS. We have a hotline. I'll give you the numbers at the end. And our team will actually come, remove the snake, and then put it back in the wild and keep it safe. So we do a lot of work with leopards as well. This is a leopard in Chhatarpur in Delhi, barely 20 minutes from here. And it was trying to leap over the fence, and it got trapped and embedded on that wall, sadly. And it of course didn't survive. Okay, and we were able to take it off. We do a lot of work with anti-poaching of bears as well. I've been told that we don't have much time, so I'll quickly skip. We also work with elephants. 98% of the wild elephant population is gone because of habitat fragmentation, railways, roads, etc., fragmenting the habitat. And this is how every single elephant that you see is captured in the wild. And then it's brutally trained by lots of beating for 6 to 8 months before it can become trained enough so you can ride it. So remember, every elephant that you ride, that you see, has been captured from the wild, separated from its mother, separated from its herd, and made into a slave like this. And then this is the sophisticated tools that are used to handle these elephants and train them and manage them. Spikes and ankushes, these hooks, and they're beaten. Basically, it's just fear and pain that are used to manage these elephants. And then they're used, of course, in temples and streets for begging, circuses, and of course, in the Amer Fort, in Jaipur, things like that. So please remember, when you see an elephant and somebody's asking you to ride it, this is what happened to the elephant. This is a case of an elephant we rescued some time ago from a temple. What do you see different in that elephant? Do you see something strange? There is no left ear on that elephant. You know, normally when you see an elephant, you imagine it to have two ears and the trunk, right? The ear was missing because they'd beaten it and it had become infected, and the entire ear got pus filled and just fell off. This is another elephant called Raju that was rescued. I have a video. If Dr. Rao will permit me, then I'll play the video in the end for you guys, and this is the elephant that we rescued. Usually when they come to our elephant conservation and care center, which is in Mathura, again 2 hours from here, you're all welcome to come and visit it, of course. We have 21 elephants at the moment in our care there. And am I out of time? Okay, sorry. But basically they come, relax, just give me a minute, I'll just close it. And they come, they rest, they never get a chance to sleep otherwise when they're working. They make friends. This is how we care for our elephants in distress. We have 5 veterinarians who work around the clock to help them. And our goal is to give them natural behavior, you know, to get the elephants to behave like they were in the wild. And we do a lot of work with volunteers, so all of you can send an email to volunteer@wildlifeexpos.org. We have 2 staff members here, Apurva and Shirina. You're welcome to connect with them and find out how you can have more wellness, you know, if you want, when you connect with animals. Just one last thing I'd like to leave you with is, you know, we have to be the change that we want to see in the world. This is Mahatma Gandhi's sayings, not what I say, but this is what I have lived by, and I found it very, very fruitful. First they ignore you, then they laugh at you, then they fight you, then you win. So if you want to do something, then you really can. So one last thing, of course, is that, you know, in our next incarnation, I believe in rebirth. So, you know, we could all be elephants or bears or monkeys. And, you know, the way we treat them today is the way we are going to be treated tomorrow. So let's try and make a difference. Thank you very much. I apologize for running over 1 minute.
Thank you, Kartick. Actually, it's very injustice to tell that you took all your work in 10 minutes. So that's how the game is. So, but what is important is he touched on policy and enforcement. He touched on human and animal interface. He touched on animal and religion interface, livelihood interface. So range of things. I think that's what is complexity of the situation. I think we all should be partners in doing something good for the welfare of this animal. That is the message you would like. Thank you very much, Kartik.
Thank you, Dr. Rao.
Are you leaving now or?
Yeah, I probably.
You are there for some time?
Or? I can probably be here for a few minutes, yes.
So you have any question? Kartik has some urgency, he has to go. Maybe 1 or 2 questions to Kartik.
Thank you. Thank you so much for accommodating that. Any questions quickly right now? No questions?
So you have understood everything.
You can email us. You can email us if you have questions, or we have 2 staff members here wearing grey Wildlife SOS t-shirts with a bear on it. Raise your hand, Shirina and Apurva. So please ask them, accost them. They'll be here till the end of the session.
Thank you very
Thank
much,
you
Kartik.
So much, Dr.
Thanks
Rao.
For your cooperation. You. I think we'll switch on to... Okay.
So we have a gift for you. Mm.
Thank you all for your patience, and I apologize for making it so quick. Thank you, sir. Thanks very much.
Absolutely.
I think they need a
photo. So we'll switch on to some interesting technology applications. We have Dr. Subeer Mazumdar. He is the director of National Institute of Animal Biotechnology. He has a wide range experience in technology development. He has worked long years on mouse genetics, genomics, and transgenics. Now he is heading an institute of Ministry of Science and Technology and leading a lot of areas in terms of animal health, animal genomics, and whatnot. We will hear from him. Dr. Subeer.
Good afternoon. I will try to bring you through the technology part of the animal sciences in 12 minutes. That's what they said. But if there is rush, let me know, Dr. I'll finish before 12. So thanks for the organizers to getting us here. And I'll be talking about the biotech avenues for animals promoting human and animal welfare. And livestock plays an important role in Indian economy. About 20.5 million people depend on livestock for their livelihood. Livestock contributes 60% to the income of all farm households, as against average of 14% for all rural households. Livestock provides livelihood to 2/3 of the rural community. It also provides employment to about 8.8% of the population in India. India has vast livestock resource. Livestock sector contributes about 4.11% GDP. So I'll be mostly talking about the livestock, that means the one which farmers keep for their livelihood. Now, what are the major biotechnological key research areas which are required to be focused? And I would like to know that most important, what we think as a biotechnologist, is animal nutrition, because the kind of feed and fodder we give is much of inferior quality as compared to the foreign countries. We definitely need to address the issues of infectious diseases. Animal reproduction is another important aspect, because several of our livestock, that means cow, buffalo, goat, they are infertile, especially buffalo. We need to put in a new bioinformatics technology to add up to the biotechnology. We definitely need to focus on animal genetics and genomics, because what we do traditionally is traditional methods of selecting a bull, but we should really use the information from the genes and genetics. We should also focus on gut microbiome, because now they say whatever bacteria resides in the gut of not only human but also the animals, they decide the health of the animal. So definitely we need to know that. And sometimes very interesting thing, disease resistance or more milk yield can be correlated to what kind of microbes are present in their body. We definitely should work with transgenic technology. That means if one of the animals, you find a gene which is extremely important for resisting a disease, or which is extremely important for producing more milk, or a bunch of genes which are important for producing more milk. So we should try to identify them and try to make herds which are disease resistant or which produce more milk. And we should definitely be focusing on diagnostics, vaccines, and also therapeutic molecules from animals. I will tell you what is that. That is the biggest biotechnological part. So some of the things I can cover in 10-12 minutes, as Dr. Rao has already said, brucellosis is one of the very, very important things. And what we should know, that brucellosis will give infertility to not only animals, but human being can get infected from animals and they can also become infertile. So that's a disease which we are focusing by identifying very crucial molecules inside our body related to brucella, and try to develop, one, to detect the animals suffering from brucellosis, and two, to develop vaccines for them. We should also definitely be isolating several host proteins which should allow us to select one protein which can be used for development of vaccine. One important thing which Dr. Rao said, that a lot of animals were having ticks. So there are a lot of animals which give less milk because you do not know that they are suffering from anemia. They don't know the cause of anemia. Lot of ticks infect several diseases inside them, including thylariasis, which causes production of less milk, and farmers hardly or rarely know that. So it is important to dissect them and try to find out. So one of the things, for example, we are working that curcumin, which is a very simple and cheaper molecule, it is actually taking care of the ticks, and it can kill ticks sitting on the body of an animal, rather than using what is called as buparovicone, which is the new which is the drug which is used at present. Now there are pathogenesis related to several diseases, and for example thylariasis, what we are trying to develop a novel diagnostic tool for understanding which animals are suffering from thylariasis. There are several goshalas where animals suffer from thylariasis and nobody cares for them, because nobody is really going to take out necessarily milk from them. They are just to take care of the animals. And these diseases we have seen in some of the goshalas, and it is very, very important to identify new genotypes which are present in India as compared to the other research done in other part of the country. Another important thing which is for animals is leptospirosis. Usually people used to think it happens to the dogs during rainy season and then human beings get it, but it is not so. Now in cattle, lot of leptospirosis can be found. So one of the studies we must take is to identify intracellular or intercellular molecules which communicate for the effect, for the pathogenesis of this disease, and try to develop some vaccine out of it. Now, a very important thing which all of us are now focusing is antimicrobial resistance. So by giving several kind of antibiotics, those who practice the livestock sector, they know that when the baby is born or when a calf is born, a lot of antibiotic is fed to the mother so that the calf grows very fast. This is the relationship.
So without any knowledge, unnecessary antibiotics are given to the animals, and that leads to development of the microbes inside the body, which become resistant to the antibiotics. What happens? These microbes are now transferred to human beings, because human beings and animals live very close. And without any fault of human beings, human beings can also get infected with such antibiotic resistant microbes. So a very, very important point is that we should identify new phenotypes of the resistant pathogens from, for example, bovine mastitis. That is the biggest one to give you disease resistant microbes. As I said, about 35% of the buffaloes in India are infertile. So one of the studies are being undertaken that you go to neurons and reproduction start in the brain actually. So GnRH, and GnRH is governed by kisspeptin. So a very important thing is coming up, that is use of kisspeptin to increase the fertility of the buffalo, which are infertile. They cannot be fertile. So that is one of the techniques we are using. And definitely there's a hyperprolificacy in goats. Some of the goat species will give you one pup, but some of the goats can give up to 3 plus minus. So you know, you have to find out why other goat is giving 3, and if you come to know using biotechnology of the genes, one of them is known as fecundity genes, but gene is known. But how that gene works, what is that protein which is actually allowing the more follicles to be ovulated, if you know that, we can use that biotechnology to induce follicular maturation and ovulation in multiple numbers from a goat and can get more babies. The other very important aspect I am going to tell, that nanoparticle based nutrient delivery for better absorption and bioavailability. Now, very important thing I will tell you, although we give lot of foods like protein, carbohydrates, fat and all that, we talk sugar, but there are lot of micronutrients like zinc, copper, manganese, molybdenum, selenium, cobalt, iron, iodine, and these are the deficiency which is impacting livestock in reduced milk production, lower conception rate, slow weight gain, disease susceptibility, weaker calves, retained placenta, silent heat. That means heat you cannot observe, so you do not know when to give sperm by intrauterine insemination to make her fertile. So there are so many diseases which is occurring because of micronutrient deficiencies. People just add this micronutrient in feed and mix them and give. It is not absorbed by the gut or intestine. So now nanoparticles should be made, which should be targeted or tagged with antibodies to the surface receptor of the cells, so that nanoparticle mediated, targeted micronutrient definitely goes inside the blood circulation and creates a good health for the animal. Now, other than that, we can also add some beautiful or wellness flora inside the gut of the animals from one animal to other. There are animals which will produce more milk because they have good gut flora, or they are disease resistant. So we can really transfer them and make the other animals which are relatively weaker or less producer to increase their production. Second thing is cloning. Cloning is that remove the original nucleus of a oocyte and insert a very good nucleus of a, for example, cloning is only possible in India when you have allied bulls. Allied bull will impregnate thousands of females in his lifetime by making semen doses. If you want to replicate making of the same bull, then you should go for cloning, because cloning is extremely expensive. Poor farmer cannot bear the cost of the cloning of a simple cow, because cow will become 35 lakhs rupees worth, nobody will buy. But if a bull becomes 35 lakhs rupees worth, it will give you 6 crores rupees in his life, because it is going to make, in one ejaculate, it can make around 100 doses of semen. So cloning is only possible there. In addition to that, we should definitely focus on lateral flow assays, especially for estrus detection, because in buffalo, you cannot detect estrus. Cow will display some symptoms, buffalo will not. If you can make some lateral flow assays, you can detect estrus easily. In addition to that, I will simply go and tell you the last very important point, that is, we need cattle FSH and LH, because they are very, very important to ovulate the females, but cost is so high, farmer cannot. So what can we do? We can produce this therapeutic protein of cattle FSH and LH in animal bioreactor. That means these proteins are produced in big companies with lot of people working, big bioreactor, fermenter, electricity, licenses, very costly. These are available, extremely costly, not for our farmers. But we can make body of an animal an industry, without any electricity, without any much expense, without any labor. How? I will tell you. For that, what you need, we have done it. This work is, we have published, and we are forwarding this with the help of DBT. We have got buffalo beta casein promoter, that is the promoter of the udder gland, milk gland of the buffalo, behind which you can tag a gene. For example, LH and FSH gene of cattle. Then what will happen? Udder gland of the buffalo will drive that gene to produce that protein in the milk, and milk is very cheap, so that protein will be very cheap. I'll explain you very nicely what it is. So this is a promoter, which means an engine, which actually drives the gene. So in body, beta-casein promoter drives beta-casein gene, and there is a stop codon, so the process stops. Here what we have done, we have isolated the engine, that is buffalo beta-casein engine, which works only in the adrenal gland, not in brain, not in liver, not in kidney, and tagged, say, LH or FSH gene, or several genes of human diseases which are required for therapeutic treatment. And when you make a transgenic animal using that, in milk, along with beta-casein, since behind this engine, we have also tagged an artificial gene that is also expressed, and the milk can produce. For example, you can take any gene from human, tag it, that gene behind the engine or buffalo beta-casein promoter, the milk of the transgenic animal made will produce that, and cost of those medicines, $14,000, human gamma interferon, you can get it for just 100 rupees a vial. That is our dream, and we have already reached half success. I will show these are the various proteins which are made for human and very, very costly for various diseases like diabetes, infertility, heart failure, anemia, cancer, hepatitis, you know. I have a range, if you want, I can talk to you. So the what we are doing, promoter of buffalo adder gland, human or any animal gene, in protein will get in the milk of the animal, and the cost can be reduced drastically. So now we have done that experiment in mice, and in the adder gland of the mice, when we collected milk, we found we could successfully generate human gamma interferon, whose vial is 13,500 rupees one vial. But if you can see, mice was giving us this much milk, but if you can go to cow or buffalo, it will be huge amount of milk, and this cost will drastically reduce. So not only human wellness, but also animal wellness can be taken care of. For example, bone morphogenic protein, which can be used for injuries of the animal for repair of the bones. That is also possible. Now, Dr. Rao is sitting here. He will always talk about genetically modified organism. That's a big problem, that if you make transgenic animals, there can be challenges. So instead of making the whole animal transgenic, what is biotechnology we are using? We are going, this is an adder gland. So we now go and directly transfect the adder gland. And what will the adder gland transfection do? They will convert these glands into transgenic, not the whole animal transgenic. There is no germline transgenesis, and the milk produced will be very good. And there is a big demand of milk in the country from milk therapeutic proteins. Now I am shifting to total volume of the milk required by the country. So we need to go from 146 million today to 180 million. 1 minute, I'll finish. So what we are doing, that conventional progeny test uses 6 to 7 years to find out a good bull, baby and his baby, and then their milk. Instead of that, as soon as the male is born, if you can do the genetic analysis of this male and find out of 10,000 male, which 5 males are elite, which will give babies of high yield. So at the birth, we can know, we don't have to wait for 6 to 7 years. For that, we are doing a high-end biotechnology. That is, we are taking various breeds of the animals, taking out their full genome analysis, and trying to find out what are the single nucleotide polymorphism in them, because of which they are different from each other. So we'll first make chip for that, and then we will make a chip for relating those genes or SNPs with the milk yield. And a formula will be driven using 10 to 20,000 females. It's not an easy job. And then a formula will come which will show association of these 9 SNPs is equivalent to a good yielding bull. And that's what we are going to do in future. This work is being initiated. Dr. Rao is steering that work. And the last thing and most important thing which Dr. Rao did touch, that in Western European countries, the male chick and female chick is separated because all males are not required. You require females for making eggs. Similarly, in India, you require females for making milk. All the bulls which are lying and staying on the road, they are not required. That is why they are useless. All bulls are not elite. Out of 10,000 bulls, maybe 4 or 5 are elite. So what you do with 9,995? They are thrown on the road or killed and thrown from the top of a hillock in villages. Those who know, who know. So we are doing a very important technology using CRISPR-Cas9, and we are targeting our genes to Y chromosome so that we either kill Y chromosome bearing sperm or make them less motile so that X chromosome bearing sperm runs fast, and when they fertilize an egg, a female is made. So that's a genetic engineering technology which we are doing. And last thing which I want to show, that One Health approach is very, very important, and it is very, very important. We know that we are very close to animals. We do suffer from a lot of zoonotic diseases, but if we take care of those diseases in animals, automatically we have taken care of those diseases in human, because they will be prevented from passing by. And with this, I would say ours is the National Institute of Animal Biotechnology with similar mission and vision. It is created by DBT, and I thank you, all of you, and hope we will be able to give you something in terms of biotechnology in future. Thanks.
Thank you, Subeer. Actually, again, you know, you have seen there is an interface between human and animal in terms of diseases, in terms of dependence, And in between these two interfaces, science and technology is an integral component. I mean, quite often science and technology uses animals to develop technology and also uses science and technology for the welfare of animals and human. That is the message. I mean, in the process, the care is taken, you know, one will be wondering that all these animal experiments, how they are doing. There are, every institute has got ethical committees. Every institute has ethical committees. Every institute has got safety and security committees. Unless these committees with doctors and some other social people approve a particular experiment, no institute will go ahead with experiments. So don't take an impression that scientist jo chahta hai, wo kar sakta hai. Aisa nahi hai. So the fabric is that you have ethical committee, and every experiment requires a committee in environment and forest, you approval of also for doing on a large scale experiments. So there are enough laws, enough technological interventions, enough consciousness about human and animal welfare interfaces. We'll now request Dr. Manilal Valliyate. He is a chief executive officer of PETA India. PETA stands for People for Ethical Treatment of Animals. So having said about ethical committees, PETA is an international organization and it is very active in animal welfare activities. Some of those common things which you have seen in the press, protecting the bulls from races, castration of animals, and several other animal welfare issues have been aptly taken up by PETA, and they have their own ideology and they have their own vision. I think we'll hear with Manilal, and equally important is animal welfare. Thank you.
Thank you, please. Thank you, sir.
I'll just start my timer.
Okay.
Okay, please go ahead.
Hello, Wellness India 2017 Expo. As you know, I'm Dr. Manilal Valliyate, the Chief Executive Officer for Animal Protection Group, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals India, better known as PETA India. I'll take you to a different route now. Often, we think of wellness, we think of exercising, right? Taking vitamins, getting rest, tests done at the doctor's office, or making other such efforts that we might consider arduous, tedious, or even expensive. But what if I told you there is an easy way to improve your own health, protect the environment, help animals, and even address world hunger? In other words, achieve wellness for ourselves and other members of our community, including animals? Well, there is a way. The answer is simple: eat plant-based food. Globally, humans are consuming more than 7 times the amount of meat that was eaten in 1950. And in India, the consumption of beef, chicken, eggs, dairy, and other animal-derived foods is rapidly increasing. In the years between 2003 and 2013, meat consumption more than doubled in our country. To meet this high demand for animal-derived foods, globally 70 billion animals are farmed a year, almost 10 times the number of humans on the planet. And most of these animals are confined to intensive factory farming systems, which deny them the opportunity to express their natural behavior. Trillions of fish are also killed, and these numbers keep racing. In India alone, an estimated 1 million chickens are killed for their flesh every 4 hours. Choosing to eat meat, eggs, and dairy products, yes, even dairy products, condemns cows, chickens, goats, pigs, and other sentient animals to a life of unmitigated suffering. If you are against killing of cows or for beef, you will want hear this. In India, cows and buffaloes are not specifically reared for beef. They are instead supplied largely by the dairy industry. so much so that if the dairy industry didn't exist, the beef industry essentially wouldn't. Male calves are considered worthless, as Rao rightly pointed out. Male calves are considered worthless by the dairy industry and are often abandoned or sent to slaughter for beef, while their mothers await the same fate when their milk production wanes. Eating egg is not humane either. Today, most chickens used for eggs are crammed into wire cages so that they can hardly spread a wing. They commonly suffer from osteoporosis and broken bones because of calcium deficiencies from such kind of breeding. And they produce unnaturally high quantity of eggs. Their feet become lacerated and wounded by the cages, and they become so frustrated from the intense confinement that these otherwise gentle birds often fight, peck at each other, and sometimes even cannibalize their distressed cage mates. So this is a very common situation in poultry farms. You'll find the farmers complaining that the chicken will peck each other, and that's the reason when they are babies, they will cut the beaks. Now, we have identified the problem and we have an immediate solution. The question is, who suffers? The question need to be looked into is why they peck each other, because there is hardly any space given to them. They are confined into a cage and imprisoned for life. So that's the reason for pecking. And like the dairy industry, the male birds born into the egg industry are considered worthless. I mean, nobody wants the male. That's because in meat industry, chickens are bred to have heavier bodies. So the chickens used for eggs and those used for meat are not the same. So the chicken used for the eggs are called layer chicken. The chicken used for the meat are called the broiler chicken. PETA recently released an eyewitness report of Indian hatcheries showing workers carelessly tossing one-day-old male and other unwanted chicks into rubbish bins to be crushed, drowned, and they are thrown into fires or grinders or tossing them into ponds at fish farms to be eaten alive. I'm going to show you a brief video about the biggest victims, at least in terms of sheer numbers, of our addiction to animal-derived foods. I do warn you that it won't be pleasant to watch, but it is only when we understand the truth that we can make informed decisions in our own lives and also inform others. Plus, if we have trouble just watching it, imagine what it must be like to endure this cruelty. Can we have the first video, please? So these are the typical factory farms that we have in India to meet our requirements for meat, egg and other things. In addition to affecting an astronomical number of animals, the extraordinary upsurge in the consumption and production of animal-derived foods in India also adversely affects human health. Water availability and other environmental concerns such as the greenhouse gas emissions and the climate change and the food supply to the poor. India tops the chance in many ailments that doctors now tell us are linked to the consumption of animal-derived foods. Cardiovascular disease is leading cause of death in India, while stroke is also a main cause of death and disability in the country. India is also the world leader in diabetes. Its cancer rate is out of control and childhood obesity is at a crisis point, but doesn't have to be this way. A study published in the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition of nearly 45,000 people in England and Scotland showed that vegetarians were 32% less likely to die of heart disease or be hospitalized for it. These individuals experienced low cholesterol levels, blood pressure, and weight. Research published in the same journal concluded that the incidence of all cancers combined was lower among vegetarians than among meat eaters. While another study found vegan diet showed statistically significant protection for overall cancer incidence in both genders combined and for female specific cancers. Vegans and vegetarians who also refrain from consuming eggs, dairy and any other animal derived foods. The research also found that the vegetarians seem to have a decreased risk of developing cancer of the gastrointestinal system. And a look at the dietary habit of more than 70,000 people by Loma Linda University in the University of US showed that those who ate a vegetarian diet had a 22% lower risk of colorectal cancer than those who are not vegetarian. Also, to keep the kilos off, plant-based diets are the best. A study from Loma Linda University found that average body mass index was lowest among vegans and highest among those who eat meat. Specifically, researchers found that only 9.4% of the vegans studied were obese, while 33.3% of the people who ate meat were obese.
Time is up.
Okay, just half minute, sir. Before I conclude, I want to show you one quick video. It's a short video. I hope that this video will explain why some of us are already vegan.
I'm vegan.
I'm vegan.
I'm vegan.
I'm vegan for animals.
For my health.
For the environment.
For the world.
The meat, egg, and dairy industries
are the leading cause of deforestation.
Consuming animal products increases your risk of suffering from heart attacks, cancer, and strokes.
Three of our biggest killers. The meat, egg, and dairy industries
treat animals like commodities
rather than living beings.
They take our resources from the people who really need them.
If everyone went vegan,
we'd all be healthier.
Animals would have better lives.
We could slow climate change.
And we could feed the world.
With so many reasons to go vegan.
Why will you?
Why will you?
Why will you?
Why will you?
If you want sources to verify what we said here,
and you should, check out the links in the description below.
Go vegan.
Go vegan. It's the right decision for your health.
For the environment.
For animals.
For the world.
Thank you.
Thank you for your attention and time.
Thank you, Manilal.
I'm vegan.
You see, I was telling in the introduction that there are different ways of approaching towards animal welfare. What is more important is that what is the rational use? One of the important thing is that are we using our resources optimally and keeping in view of the welfare of all those living organisms around us, including the environment, you know. So I think these are some stories. I don't know about whether you will opt for a vegetarian, vegan, or only poultry, only egg, I don't know. But what is more important is the message take home is that there is enough cruelty meant to be done with animals. I think we should see that such trend is arrested. So we'll have a next speaker, Dr. Vijay Pal Singh. Vijay Pal Singh is Assistant Professor in Academy of Scientific and Innovative Research. He is also in CSIR, Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology. He has been with the CSIR for a long time. Vijay Pal would also share some thoughts about animal welfare.
So, hello everyone. So, I am the last. So, last means I have the liberty to go beyond for 2-3 minutes, sir.
But I will tell you what, why, how, and when mammal welfare. And scientific aspect of that animal welfare. Because I come from a farming background, I don't agree with Dr. Manilal 100% what he showed about this farming, etc. Because we lived with animal like a family. It was not like a farm. And we lived with animal like they are the member of our society, or like our family. So that is partly true. The problem is that why should we do welfare? Because our law says to avoid unnecessary suffering to animal. Prevention of cruelty to animal says unnecessary. But how do you define unnecessary? Because unnecessary means basically very basic, poor. And optimal is something very high. So a farmer decided to chop the horns of his cattle and take it to the slaughterhouse. So I'm giving one example. And he thought it is absolutely necessary. So police caught him and there is to the slaughterhouse. And the policeman said, you have done a necessary suffering to the animal because you have chopped the horns. Farmer said, no, you are wrong. It's suffering that is caused to animal because of chopping of hair is very much required. Why? Because I can pack more number of animal in the truck and also I can carry more number, the animal will not fight in between. So they will not injure each other. So how do you decide what is necessary and what is unnecessary? It is very difficult. We have a law which is nothing but cut, copy, paste from UK. So UK people have changed, we have not changed. And still this unnecessary suffering is there. And we don't know how to define in most of the time. So my question and understanding about the suffering is basically three level. Whatever the suffering happens, wherever it happens, you have to first ask, is there a suffering first? Was it necessary? Or the person who is doing that suffering is a normal person or is a mad person? So in this case, if you see the formula, did animal suffer because of chopping of the horns? Yes or no? Yes. Was it necessary or could have avoided? Avoided. Or that person was a normal person or a mad person? Normal person, because he's talking about the economy and also money and everything. So he's a normal person. So is this suffering a normal suffering? Is this a necessary or unnecessary suffering? What do you think? Unnecessary. So put the everything, whatever you do, into three formula. Is this suffering necessary? Was it necessary or the person normal? So with this, we have to first define what is welfare. If you ask a scientist what is welfare, they will say it is interference in my science. If you ask a normal person what is welfare, they will think we will get something free from the government everywhere. Welfare means Ministry of Environment and, sorry, Ministry of Agriculture and Farmer Welfare. So farmer expect they will get something free, either fertilizer or tractor or cycle, whatever. Or if you ask a normal doctor like me, veterinary animal doctor, what is welfare means health. If animal is healthy, welfare is okay, but that's not welfare. Welfare of an individual as it state, as regard is attempt to cope with the environment. How it is coping with the environment? We are here and we are doing very well. Suddenly you say snake or a cobra in, besides me, welfare goes down. Will I cope up, stay with the cobra? That's up to me. Otherwise, welfare is gone down. Welfare is also including either you cope with it or you don't cope with it. It is a science. And welfare is also having a control on mental capability. Not only bodily. Most of the time we think bodily control. You provide feed, water, blah, 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 and then welfare is okay. If you put me into Tihar jail, my welfare is poor or down. If you put me into jail, what about my welfare? Go down or up? Down, because I have everything, food, bed, water, everything is there. But no mental thing, mental stimulation. I cannot go out, I cannot go for movie, I cannot go for talk. Hence, animal also need that part. Mental control of their environment. If that is not there, the welfare is not proper. And welfare always refer to living animal. If animal is dead, no welfare. And it is the characteristic of an individual. My welfare is different. Pig welfare is different. If pig you house into the clean environment, they don't like that. They like to always snout. They like to dig this one. So it is the characteristic of the individual. And animal protection is something human do to the animal. So what PETA and all people are talking, it is not welfare, but animal protection. Welfare is to understand what animal want, what they need, and try to provide that if possible. Not always possible. What Dr. S.R. Rao said, that he saw in Mathura so many cows are lying. Because our mental setup is like this. We have nearly emotionally hardened. We don't understand, oh, they are like this and they will be like this. We don't understand that. So, they are like that. If we understand that to be in their position, we may do something. Animal welfare is a science. And you have university, you have department, and you have many things outside India where the animal welfare is taught. But still, we are doing animal welfare here in India is more a political science, not a science. Most of the time, our laws, our things are based not on the science, but on politics, our opinion. But it is basically, we need to ask and understand. We have an institute called as National Institute of Animal Welfare, which has never seen the daylight, because I don't know certain reason. So welfare is basically not the religion, not the speculative metaphysics, and not shamanistic worldview. It is the science to understand animal. We need to validate understanding animal through the experiment. Either you falsify or you prove it, this is meaningful. How the welfare started? It started from Cambridge University by Bramble report. So he went from farmer to farmer place and he was asking farmer, what about the animal? They said, okay, don't disturb us, like in India. We are feeding them, breeding them, they are giving baby and we are putting milk and everything. But that is not the complete view of welfare. And they gave the concept of five freedom, freedom from hunger, freedom from thirst, and freedom from blah, blah, blah. So we'll not go much into it because of the time. And basically, welfare is the our obligation because our Constitution 51A say that we will become compassionate towards animal. What compassion means? Not talk, but go and do something. If you see something, if you simply talk, oh, animal, or, we should do something, it is sympathy. No. If you go and do something, that is, means you are more compassionate. Compassionate means you are more humans. We are all humans for sure, but we are not humane. Okay, as we see our the suffering all around us, you can measure welfare. You can measure the welfare by cortisol, you can measure the welfare by hormone, you can measure the welfare by behavior. If suppose in India on a road, a person is carrying the chicken upside down, everybody see, nobody stops. Because we have started to believe this is the only way to carry the chickens. And they don't suffer. You ask and stop that person why you are carrying upside down. They said, ki sir, aise le jana hai. Kya dikkat aapko? So basically, we have emotionally hardened and wired like that. We have forgotten what is normal. For that, we need to understand the behavior of animal and which is the animal welfare science. If you have a pig which is means in a sow crate and all the time biting, it is reproducing, it is giving the baby, it is having normal weight, but all the time bite the bar, it means the animal is not normal. If you see a buffalo all the time doing tuck, 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 it means behavior is normal, not normal. But does farmer know what is normal? No. So it is important to understand that you can measure the welfare by different parameters, behavior, pathology, body shape, ability to grow and all. Why should we do welfare? We always have the anthropocentric view, means what human thing is best is always best for animal. That's the most stupid idea. No, animal are different. Their abilities are different. Primates are closer to us, but fish are also as good as like primate. But we don't understand fish as like means they are living being. But the experiment have proved that fish is as equal important intelligent like monkey or a primate, which we say is closer to us. So learning, okay sir, discrimination and recognition animal can do. Also they can do innovation like a crow. If you feed the bread, they will drop into this water. They will ask, let the fish comes, they will eat the fish, not the bread. So they are very innovative. They have the capabilities. They don't want anything free. So you have the heifer, give the, something in free, they will not take. If they have to do something and have access to food, they will take. They have the feeling and emotions. Most of the time, this is again the biggest problem. you cut the part of the animal and they don't make noise. If they don't make noise, it means they are not suffering. That is again a biggest problem with us, because we think if we have pain, we will cry. But if you cut any part of sheep, they don't vocalize, they don't make noise. It does not mean they are not suffering. They are suffering. They are different. They express their pain in a different way. But we think whatever is to us is also applicable to, animal, which is wrong. So they have the feeling, they have the emotions, and they have the guilt and anger. Because of the security of time, I cannot say. Their needs are different. When the buffalo is pregnant, their needs are different. When they are normal, their needs are different, which have been proved by all animal experiments. Genetically modified animal like broiler, which used to grow by 2 to 2.5 kg in 12 weeks, it is now in 35 days ready. So we have a problem, because you see the most of the time they're hawks, they are lame, and they all have suffering. The same is with the cows. If you see one example here in the sheep, what sheep don't like? A man. No animal like man. And if you see the approach of a man with a dog, that is not at all like by sheep. Okay? So their heart rate, their skin and everything goes beyond these things. It means they don't like our presence. So again, this is the another important point I want to make, that when we do something by emotions, when cows are on the road, they are suffering for very long time. Intensity of suffering is there, and also time is there. It means we are not helping them, but we are more putting them into the trouble. Because the time and intensity both are high, the welfare is a big issue. So I think this is the area which is, and this is another point that we consider welfare is only health. This is the study we have done with Mathura Veterinary College, where we consider the health is only the past, which is not true. So I am going to, how to ask animal what they like. So how you ask? If you ask me, I will reply. But how you ask animal? They don't speak like us. It is, then you do behavioral test or preference test. Either you like to be in this room or you like to be in another room. So provide both the environment and let them spend the time, and you know what they like. So that is called as a preference test for the animal. Animal also don't understand pain as like we. Because if they think that they have the pain, it is not going to end. If I know I have the pain, it will end soon, as soon as I reach to hospital. But it will not end with the animal, because they don't rationalize. So this is another example that we should understand animal not by extrinsic value. Extrinsic value by food, companionship, that is okay. But also understand animal what they want. If I drink the milk of my buffalo, I should know what buffalo like. Buffalo like to go into the pond, which in our called as a jhod. If you take them into the jhod, they like it. So that is a welfare. Okay? So that is the intrinsic value of the buffalo. And what is extrinsic value? I get a lot of milk. So I agree partially with Manilal what the video says, but we live with animal like a family. Can we really call ourselves animal carer when he allows mechanization, complacency, uncritical satisfaction and self-satisfaction to perpetuate what is in rational context is cruelty. So my last message to you, try to be humane, not be humans. We are all humans, but not human. Try to be compassionate. Animal welfare is different from animal protection. Mind it, welfare is science, protection is not science. Necessary and unnecessary, ethics and welfare, and compassion and sympathy. Sympathy, you talk. We all talk a lot. But do we do something for animal? No, hardly anything. Thank you very much. What we are doing, so we are doing a training program in my Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology of 2 weeks, where we train people how to become compassionate human being, how to understand animal, how to ask question to animal. So with that, thank you very much, sir. I'm sorry for the...
So, I will not further interpret anything, but just we'll take some one or two questions. Yeah, please introduce and one line of a question. Please don't give any long questions, just straightforward. No, normally what happens? I understand that it won't be not long.
Don't worry about it. It will be educative. I am a dairy farmer as well. So one question to Dr. Saab about ticks. So you said curcumin?
Curcumin. Now, yeah, we have
curcumin from haldi?
Yes, exactly.
Okay. So that helps.
In vitro studies.
Okay. I have another thing from Ayurveda. Aapka tare meere ka tel jo hai. If you feed it to the animals,
which oil?
Taramira. Choice sahab ko pata hoga. Taramira jante aap? Mustard ki quality mein se hota hai. Taramira agar aap feed karte hain animal ko.
Ha ha.
Ya uske tel se aap hum lassi mila ke nahalaya karte the. To ticks control ho jate.
Chale jate the.
Chale jate hain. Aur taramira khilayenge to ticks lagenge hi nahi.
Okay.
और आपकी जो साहिवाल नस्ल है, गिर नस्ल है, जो इधर राजस्थान में पलती हैं, इनको टिक्स लगते ही नहीं हैं।
लगते ही नहीं।
इसीलिए ऑस्ट्रेलिया वालों ने जेबू बनाई है और इंपोर्ट किया था।
Correct.
So that is basic thing. We need to understand why is it so.
Exactly.
Plus on the animal behavior, the people those who have animals in the desert, वो घेर के बैठते हैं अपने मालिक को। वो मालिक उनके बीच में सोता है। अगर उनका कोई दुश्मन आ जाए, so they are the ones those who save him. So that is the welfare.
Yeah, yeah.
I've kept a dairy and I've been communicating with my animals. It was famous in that particular area. A bull had killed two people. And that bull used to talk to me. So I'm agreeing with you. That is very, very important to be compassionate. And coming down to this, aapne Singh ke baare mein baat ki. The horns. हमारे देहात में क्या है कि सिंह चोपड़ते थे हम तेल से और वो ये सबसे बड़ा रीजन है कि उसके यहाँ अंदर जो है वो इचिंग होती है जिसकी वजह से भैंस और गाय जो ऐसे करती है और जो लड़ते हैं उनका स्वभाव भी इसीलिए होता है. But homeopathy has a great role to play in it. I've always treated my animals by homeopathy and Ayurveda and it works. I can talk on the subject for a long time, but thank you very much.
Thank you for your inputs. One more question. Last question. Somebody who is youngest here.
Well, my question is for Dr. Manilal. I have seen a lot of videos, the one that you have shown from India and from Europe. But I have also seen in those videos that the most recognized the sector is for the animal and dairy farming. Then there is a lot of exploitation. So I also feel that in India, the sector is unrecognized and unorganized. So what do you want to say about it, that if the dairy farming sector is unorganized and in Europe we have more organized, so where the exploitation is more?
So your question is whether the farming industry is organized in India, right? That's the question. Unorganized. Okay. I would say whether Europe or India, over the period of time when the demand for the animal products increased, there was a surge of factory farming. I mean, it was the same case with Europe and it was the same case with India and other Asian countries. Now, it from the very beginning, it was totally unorganized and it continued to be unorganized. And even if there is an attempt to organize it, I mean, for example, in Europe have decided to go cage-free. Now, they won't be keeping birds in cages for egg production, which means they will be putting the birds in free range. So that, and they often call it humane egg, or similarly the milk production. Now the cattle won't be tied in a barn, so there are companies who say, claim that these animals will be left in the open. They graze throughout the day and eat the grass, and in the evening they use the milking machine and take the milk. So I would say from the perspective of welfare, things are changing. There are efforts being done to cater to the needs of the animals, but that is from the animal welfare perspective, that whatever the animal needs, we are trying to provide. We are not tying them at one place. We are not forcing them to lie down on their own feces and the urine, but we are allowing them to move out. But there are some components which are still being not addressed. For example, nobody need a male calf. So those technologies, even as Sir said, that the biotechnology is, I mean, over the period of time, it has brought in a lot of good technologies, like not even having male calves. But there are certain things which are inherently cruel in an industry. I mean, nobody want to live in a place where there will be lot many other animals, and they all are kept for a certain purpose. Eventually, they have to die. They'll be sent to slaughter, and dying is not at all a pleasant experience at all. And the milk which the cows produce is meant for the calves. I mean, somebody else drinking it, again, that is also not part of it. So from the welfare perspective, yes, somebody saying this is humane meat and humane milk, and I mean, feel good about it. But again, whose reality counts? If we come to that question, if we start thinking about animals' reality counts, then of course, none of these regulations are going to help for the animals.
Thank you very much. I think it was a very balanced and scintillating discussion. There was many sides of the view, but ultimately, the policy, technology, and socio-economic fabric of the country, they all determine how humane we are. I think the last slide which Dr. Vijay showed is that be humane, you know. If you are human, I am surprised, animal ko chhod dijiye. We have to be humane to humans first. We have forgotten even that. And then we have to be, I think the message take home is be human, behave like a human. I think thank you very much. I think we'll close the session. Thanks to the organizers for an excellent arrangement and making us all comfortable. Thank you to all the audience. Main sabse zyada respect audience ko deta hu, speakers ko nahi. Because you have a patience to hear all of us, whatever we said. Thank you for your cooperation and thank you very much to all.
Thank you so much, all eminent panelists, for your contribution to Wellness India Conference. I now request Dr. S.R. Rao to please present a token of appreciation to all our panelists. Dr. Subeer S. Mazumdar, Dr. Manilal Valliyate, Dr. Vijay Pal Singh, and here's a token of appreciation for our session chair, Dr. S.R. Rao.